Welcome to Italics, television for the Italian-American experience. I'm your host, Anthony Tamburri. On this special issue of Italics, we feature Fabio Finotti, director of the Istituto Italiano di Cultura, or the Italian Cultural Institute here in New York, and Joseph Sciame, chairman of the Italian Heritage and Culture Committee of New York. Welcome. We're here at the Italian Cultural Institute, otherwise known as the Istituto Italiano di Cultura, with its sort of new director, who's been here 7 months, Dr. Fabio Finotti, Direttore dell'Istituto Italiano di Cultura.
Thank you so much. We are eager to open the Institute, because I think that I can consider myself really New York only when the Institute will be open to the population, to all the people who love Italian culture. And now we are trying to put it in order, to make a beautiful opening, I hope, around October or November.
Great. You lived in the United States, so this is not really something new for you. No. You spent 10 years in Philadelphia at the University of Pennsylvania.
20 years.
20 years in
yes.
Philadelphia? Oh my God.
So much.
20 years, you were there for as professor, the
yes.
Mariano De Vito chair. Then you went back to Italy, and here you are now as the director of the Istituto Italiano yeah. di Cultura. That has to be a really sort of satisfying change, let's say, in profession, right?
I was very happy when I was in Philadelphia at UPenn, because UPenn is a wonderful university. We had a very beautiful Italian program and also a center for Italian culture, civilization. But of course, the Italian Cultural Institute is different right. because there are even more connections with the economic activities in the States and in Italy, and with diplomacy. We are very much connected with the Italian General Consulate in New York and with the embassy. We are trying to do what in Italy is called promozione integrata, integrated promotion,
right,
something
right.
like this, in order to maximize our efforts and our investment.
This is all part of the Sistema Italia,
exactly,
right?
Exactly.
The whole
and the idea, I think it's a very good idea, because the Italian civilization was built not only by intellectuals or artists, but by merchants, by navigators, by people who were moving around Europe in order to make business. And in the same time, they were able to spread the Italian culture and to bring the global culture in Italy. So I think this connection between business and civilization, business and humanism, is very representative mm-hmm. of Italian history.
For me, your interest in Italian diaspora or Italian American yeah. studies dates back to the early 2000s, because I remember you were still at the University of Trieste, you invited
yes,
three
sir.
Of us from the United States, myself, Peter Caravetti,
yes.
and Graziella Parati. And that's been an interest of yours, Italian American or Italian diaspora studies.
Yes, the theme was at the time, the theme of the boundaries.
Right.
Because I thought that it was a period when the boundaries were becoming porous, we could say. But this sort of boundaries is not a limit that divide, but places that combine cultures. For me, is one of the big theme, one of the theme I love, and one of the a part of the Italian identity, because we are we have a lot of boundaries also within Italy, between different regions,
right.
between different cities, or even between different parts of the same city. Just think about the Palio of
Siena. I was just thinking about
there
that.
Is a fight. So.
Right.
We love boundaries,
yeah.
We are very campanilisti, we are linked to our bell tower,
exactly.
and we have a lot of different bell towers,
yeah.
but at the same time we are able also to combine all these differences, and this is a part of the Italian civilization. a lot of differences, much more than the differences you find, for instance, in France, where Paris was the center of the civilization. We have a lot of capital, a lot of differences, but the capacity of also of combine them in only one culture.
Right. So when you came in the end of January, the Instituto hadn't had a director for well over a year. So you found, in a sense, and I'm saying this in a positive way, a tabula rasa, mm-hmm. right, on which you could really build. So that being said, I know one of the things, because you privileged me with the interview early on, is that you did the Stanze Italiane. And if you want to speak a little bit to that and maybe also to some activities you have in mind that you're planning as best we can in COVID.
Yes, there was no program also because of the COVID. Right. But I immediately thought that we had to build a sort of virtual institute. And what I thought about was the beautiful idea of a great Renaissance man, Giulio Camillo, mm-hmm. who imagined the theater of the memory, a sort of building where you have different rooms, a virtual building, different rooms for different topics. The Stanze Italiane is a virtual building where we put different contents during this month, different events. And the title is beautiful also because stanze, of course, are a space, but stanze in Italian is also a structure, a musical and a poetic
and a structure.
So it's linked not only to the architecture, but also to language and to music.
Great. And what's on the horizon? What do you have that you can talk to us
about? Yes, we opened the stanze with many events and many exhibitions linked to Dante, because this year is devoted, we should say, to Dante, and trying always to link the past with the present. For instance, new poetry inspired by Dante, or works of art like jewelry, the jewelry designed by a great artist like Palladino for Dante. And not only Dante, but gardens, because gardens are a way of dealing with the landscape, with the place where you live, and they were in a way, they are also in a way able to show us that Italy is not a natural place, it's a cultural place, it's not like the United States. And then many, many events that link Italian with the United States. For instance, the series of conferences made by Laura Mattioli about American artists who are inspired by Italian works of art. For me, this is crucial, the merging of different cultures. And this is the horizon where we are moving also in the next months. Mm-hmm.
You mentioned Laura Mattioli because her father was a great collector and a great art historian.
Yes, and she organized the CIMA, the Center for Italian Modern Art. We have two major organizations here for art in New York. One is Magazzino, mm-hmm. of course, and the other one is CIMA. CIMA is more devoted to a sort of a history of contemporaneity. Magazzino is more devoted to young people. Well, and in November, we are going to reopen the institute with an exhibition organized by Magazzino about a young artist who is not Italian, but he decided to work in Italy. And this is for me crucial, because there are the Italian American, there are the Italian Egyptian. The Italy is a choice, not only it's not only a question of blood, of descendants, but it's a cultural choice in many cases.
Yeah, that whole idea of minimizing quote-unquote biography and highlighting instead the actual act, the performance, whether it be artistic, whether it be literary, etc.
You can understand in this way that really Italy has a global breath, right. Can we say this?
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's able to connect people from different heritages, from different cultures. They decide to be at least partially Italians.
So this leads, this reminds me, because I know you're also quote unquote a fan.
This reminds
I was going to say our elder statesman Bassetti, Piero Bassetti, and his notion of Italici, and the whole idea that you don't have to be Italian.
Yes, because I always reminded my students that one of the best Italian concerto was written by Bach, who probably never traveled around Italy. Yeah. So many people decided to, in the great tour, the so-called great tour, Italian was a privileged destination because everybody wanted to be at least a little partially Italian, and everybody wanted to bring back Italy. So the most beautiful collection of Italian landscape by Canaletto is in England. The owner is the Queen, not in Italy. Right. So all these questions about identity, we are going to organize in at the end of October a seminar where I hope that you can join the speakers about Columbus, because this is really a big question about Columbus in the past, but also Columbus in the present. Speaking about Columbus, I think we can understand not only the history of colonization, but in a way, the way what we decided to be as Italian now, the character of our identity now. So I hope that this seminar that will collect people and academics, of course, because we want to be not so much ideological, but at least more scientific. Mm-hmm. At the end of October, I think it will be a great occasion to think about Italian identity.
Mm-hmm. It's a courageous act on your part.
Yes, but we are also organizing something less problematic. In connection with the end of Medici's exhibition, for instance, there will be a seminar about the Medici and the poison. The art of poisoning in during Italian Renaissance. Because you know that there is all the legend about Caterina de' Medici, right, using gloves. Yeah. So we decided, and I remember that the Medici series, which had a great success in Italy, I think that the first episode, there was one of the Medici dying because there was some grape, some poisoned grape. So this is in the imagination of people in the States, but also in Italy. And in a way, it's not completely a mistake, because poisoning and medicine are very strictly connected. And Medici were able to promote also the research about plants, about medicine, etc. So there will be some less problematic, but more amusing argument, and also about the Medici, another one about the food and the decor of the table in a Medici in the middle of October. Yes.
Oh, wonderful. So let me ask you, the Istituto, with regard to Italian culture from a curriculum point of view, an academic point of view, is the point of reference, right?
Yes.
Whereas the Italian consulate general is the point of reference for a K-12.
Yes.
Correct.
They are two separate buildings, two separate administration. But I must say, with this consulate, we have a wonderful collaboration.
Yeah.
Great collaboration. Because it's clear that when we organize a cultural event, there are reflection on the image of Italy, and now we speak about the cultural diplomacy. Mm-hmm. So diplomacy and culture must work together.
And also the relationship of Italian culture to here, the United States, more specifically, the Northeast, and so on and so forth, right? And it's not just with Italian Americans, it's with other groups as well. I mean, when you think, this being the year of Dante, the 19th century was full of translations into English of Dante, right? And then, of course, some of us see the onset of immigration as sort of unfortunately overshadowing the cultural aspect.
Right? You are so right. Yeah. Next year, so we move on. Yeah. We spoke a little about this year. Then there will be a beautiful exhibition during Christmas about Christmas decorations.
Yeah.
With the summer workshop, how to create Italian Christmas decoration, and probably a presepe coming from Naples.
Ah.
So we are going to decorate the Institute for Christmas holiday. But after next year, one of the big themes will be Frederick II.
Okay.
His capacity to move the empire from the center of Europe to southern Europe and connect Arabian culture, Norman culture, French culture, Latin and Greek culture and Jewish culture. So you are totally right. It's not just a question of a relation between Italy and the States, but it's a relation between different civilizations. Chinese too, because of course we are also with Marco Polo, and Chinese are very active in the States. And we have to look after all these links that Italy was able to create in the past in order to keep them also in the present.
Mm-hmm. Federico II is very interesting because it's the beginning also of la letteratura italiana.
Exactly.
La scuola siciliana, la
scuola siciliana,
right?
Yeah. And you know that, you know that when I tried to explain this to some people at a dinner, this is why I thought we have to organize something about Federico II. And they told me, no, it's impossible. The Italian poetry comes from Tuscany. No, I'm sorry, it's from Sicily.
Exactly.
And from the south, and as well as, for instance, the medical school, because we are also creating a link with the University of Federico II. There was the Scuola Salernitana, that was a great medical school in the time of Federico II. So it's really a way, and this is an example of cultural diplomacy, a way to suggest that Italy should not only look at the Europe, but should have also a big role in the Mediterranean context, and should look also to the south.
Mm-hmm.
And this is probably the future of Europe, if we are able to connect Europe with what's happening in Africa.
Yeah, the whole Mediterranean.
The Mediterranean area, right, yes.
Right. The whole rethinking, I think, that has to take place.
Yes, and of course, not in colonialistic terms.
No.
I wouldn't like someone told me, you are going back to the Latin idea of a Mare Nostrum. No,
yeah.
It's
yeah.
not because the Mediterranean is a Mare Nostrum, but because from the ancient time, it was really a place, a crossroads of cultures.
Yeah.
And it must be again what it was in the past.
And it reminds me of course, one quote unquote Italian writer who is from the Mediterranean, and I'm thinking of Amara Lacus,
for example. Right? You are right.
Who's Algerian, who at a certain point had to leave Algeria, come to Italy, and then sort of recreates himself as an Italian satirical novelist.
Yes. Yeah. And you know that we have a sort of immigration of Italian from Italy to North Africa after retirement, also because of the taxation regime, but also because they feel themselves at home.
Yeah.
It's important enlarged Italy, we could say, that we have to look about.
I want to get back to the presepio for a second, because when you were talking about it, reminded me of course, the presepio is traditionally thought of as a Neapolitan, right? A Neapolitan object art, right? Object art. And of course, in Naples, there's that wonderful museum up at San Telmo, I think it is.
Yeah, actually, we had the contact with the region of Campania, and they promised to send us a wonderful Napolitan presepio. And it's very interesting because the presepio is always something new. Yeah. There are always some new images linked to the present. So it's really alive. Yeah. You can buy today, I think that you have also the small statue of Biden or Mattarella, for instance. Everything which is present on the scene of life is present in the presepio, which is not actually only Napolitan, because one of the first ones also to create a presepio was San Francesco. The idea that the past was living, the presepio is this.
That's right.
That the past is the faith is not only the past, but it's the present, and that the child is the birth of the child is something that happens every day, every year. But it's also a great work of art, really. Yeah. I love also to think about the music, which is connected to presepe, Fosso delle Liguori, etc. They created this new music, the pastorale, that was used then by many, many composers. So it's a great tradition of popular art, and this is also something that the Institute should take care about. Mm-hmm. Not only the high art, but the beautiful, wonderful, popular art that is created by artists that you sometimes don't know, and they are without name. But they are great artists because they are able to carry on a great tradition.
So let's switch gears a little bit. So you, as Professor Fabio Finotti, are you able to do some of your own intellectual work as director? Does it stimulate you to go on to other things?
Yes, I try not to be present in all the initiatives.
Right.
Because my idea is that as director, I should disappear in a way, the events must introduce, I have to introduce, to leave the podium to other people.
Right.
So I am, of course, in the case of Columbus, I'm writing, and I also writing some other things that I love about the strong women in the Middle Ages. So I work as a director, but in the meantime I keep my small room, a small corner for my work.
And who are some of these women besides Caterina da Siena?
No, for instance, Matilde di Canossa. Mm-hmm. The woman who forced the emperor to be on his knees in front of the Pope, and who was able really to dominate a sort of small reign in Italy, freeing herself from her different husbands. Mm-hmm. Because she was able to be the one who was holding the power and not leaving it in the hands of her husbands, plural. So we have some of these women who are fascinating in our Middle Ages. I'm trying to write their history as if they were narrating it. So there is an historical point of view, of course, because I try to be always a professor. Mm-hmm. So look at the sources and all the documents, but to make them alive as if they were speaking about themselves. Because this is crucial. The women must have their voices.
Yeah, yeah. Well, when you're done with that, we'll invite you to the Kleiner Institute so you don't have to do it in-house.
Thank you. I would be happy.
And you could just wear your hat as scholar and not as director.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, good. Anthony. Well, listen, I want to thank you for taking time out from your busy day, or I should say busy days.
Thank you.
And we're looking forward to collaborating in the future.
Absolutely. And I hope that this meeting where you entered the institute is suggesting an open door of the institute for many, many other people when in October I hope we will be able to start again with our public initiatives.
We feel extremely welcome. Thank you. Thank you. I'm delighted to be here with Joseph Sciame, whose day job is Vice President for Community Relations for St. John's University. And within the Italian-American community, population, whoever we want to call it, he has held numerous national offices. He is past president of the Order Sons of Italy. He is currently president of the foundation of the Order Sons of Italy. He was also chair of the Conference of Presidents of Major Italian-American Organizations. He's here today with yet another hat, and that is president of the Italian Heritage and Culture Committee of New York. I have to take a deep breath and welcome you.
I'm sure our audience is not much interested in that. They're interested in heritage and culture.
And here we are. And you've been president for a while now. We've been doing these conversations for a while now, and it's always a pleasure. This is also a special year because it's 45 years of the Italian Heritage and Culture Committee of New York. So why don't you give us a little bit of a history of when it was founded, who founded it, and where we are today.
As many of us have known over the years, back in 1976, it was a Dr. Angelo Giamondo, who is alive and well and in touch with us once in a while, but well retired from education. He and a group decided that we should have an Italian Heritage Culture Week. And then they realized that a week was just not enough to celebrate Italian heritage and culture. And so it became a month with the approval of the city. And as a result, we worked collaboratively with elementary schools, middle schools, high schools, and colleges to constantly produce a theme each year. And so over the years, we've had 45 years of themes. And when we look through this year's program booklet, maybe later we can show the audience all those posters and how beautiful they were. Last year we had a wonderful celebration about Federico Fellini on his 100th year. And as you know, the Calandra Institute played such a pivotal role in that with weekly seminars and interviews with experts on the life of Fellini. So this year, on the 700th anniversary of Dante's passing, it was determined that this should be the celebration. And it has been a banner year so far. And the way it worked was on March 25th, we assembled at the Dante Park, which is right opposite Lincoln Center. And most people pass that statue, they have no idea who that is in the middle of the trees that are beautiful. And one would almost say that the people from Lincoln Center need to cross the street. But we were there, we were probably about 50 strong, and we were surprised to have the mayor of the city of New York, Mayor de Blasio, who came to that ceremony. So that was really our kickoff. And it was a beautiful tribute. We had students there from La Scuola d'Italia who did beautiful poetry readings. And as well, we had a Professor Luigi Ballarini who is going to be the recipient of the 2021 Leonardo da Vinci Award that we present annually.
So we should also say that when the mayor came, he recognized Luigi Ballarini because Luigi was his professor
in
college.
Was that not a coincidence?
It was amazing. Exactly, that was great.
How they embraced one another and reflected on their past.
So that was
really good. Yeah. We thought that the mayor was coming because his son's name is Dante. And we had hoped he would bring him, but he wasn't able to make it that day.
We should say that his daughter's name is Chiara.
Yes.
So we have Dante and Chiara, names
beautiful.
Of two important figures in Italian history.
Two beautiful names.
Yeah.
And also, we returned to the park on September 14th, which is the day that we did not realize, but the City Parks Commission decided on the 100th anniversary of the placement of the Dante statue at that park area that they would refurbish it. They would clean it up, polish it up, and they did a magnificent job. And once again, thanks to one of our board members, Ufficiale Amico Delianova Legastro, he was able to coordinate much of the work with the parks. And as you know, you were there. Mm-hmm. And once again, we had preeminent people attend. And I believe that Professor Ballarini's son was also able to give us a few lines of poetry and extend greetings. So it was a magnificent day. And the night culminated with an incredible dinner. As you know, being a board member, as you are, of the Italian Heritage and Culture Committee of New York, we were sitting around and thinking, well, what else could we do? And I said, we have to have a dinner. And people said, oh yeah, let's have a dinner, we'll all go out. I said, no, we need a dinner to honor Dante, but with the food and drink that Dante would have had 700 plus years ago. And thanks again to Cavalieri Dr. Berardo Paradiso, we were able to pull it off at the Il Gattopardo restaurant in New York City. We were 75 strong. We capacity crowd, everybody vaccinated, everybody tested when they came in. And the dinner was incredible. And it was typical food that Dante would have had. And we learned a lot about Dante that night. Dante liked eggs. And the first course was a bit controversial. People commented to me, they said, what kind of a first course is that? It's more like breakfast food. But Dante apparently liked eggs. And these eggs were made up and then put on a bed of almost a crust and with some greenery around it. And he's known just for his eggs. That was his that was his beloved food. Who would have ever thought that?
Yeah.
And we had wonderful wines. And the evening was spectacular. And we were graced by the presence of the new consul general to New York, Fabrizio Di Micheli, and his lovely wife, who is a major consul at the United Nations. As well, we had the director of the Italian Culture Center, Fabio Finotti, and as well, we had Cesare, who is the new deputy director, deputy consul general of New York. So it was a banner event.
It was a great evening, yeah, and of course, we had this very curious menu of that harks back to the Middle Ages.
And the pig.
And the pig, porchetta, right, exactly. We should say that March 25th, Italy proclaimed it Dante Day, because it is thought to be the beginning of the pilgrim's voyage through the three realms, Inferno, Purgatorio, and Paradiso, and instead September 14th is the presumed date of his death.
Yes.
And yeah. So those two dates become really important within this commemoration of Dante. 700 years. Amazing.
If right. I could, I would love to show this. This is a wonderful poster that was created in many different steps, but it was finalized by a young man from Italy, Giampaolo. And he produced it and sent it over to us, and the board accepted it. And so this is going to be shown throughout the world. And we have been very fortunate, by the way, because of a gentleman, Goffredo Palmerini, who picked up our news releases and stories and posters, and he has been sending it all over the world. We are getting commentary from Venezuela, Argentina, Australia. So it's absolutely amazing. And also, wonderful bookmarks that have been produced. These were brought together by Nancy Indelicato, who is our PR person and media relations. And of course, you know, because you have been in the booklet that was put together. And I have to thank Calandra Institute, because without the help here of primarily one person who was absolutely incredible, Cavalieri Joan Marchi Migliori. Joan sends out the word for the programs. She collects the programs. Your staff, Mariana Prestigiacomo, types them all up. Then we proof them. And as you know, I spent 7 days of my life here proofing.
You did.
But it was good, and you helped me, because you're a good proofreader, as always, with all of your books in this library. And so as a result, I think we have a wonderful booklet this year.
The poster, this is one of the more, let's say, somber, serious portraits of Dante, as opposed to some of the other portraits where they show a really angry Dante.
Yes, yes.
You know, and we have one of them here by Onorio Ruotolo. We have a bust that he did back in 1919 of a Dante that is rather angry. He's also been portrayed in painting less than that. But
do you think he was a serious person primarily because of his work?
I think that Dante is truly not just a world-class figure, but has had an impact on Western poetry, Western literature in general, Western poetry. People forget that he wasn't just a poet, he was a philosopher, he was a political scientist, he was a theoretician of language. He did all of this, and of course he was the one bouncing off of what's called the Scuola Siciliana, where they, the first group of writers a few decades before who wrote in the vernacular, he was the first to really popularize the vernacular vis-a-vis Latin. He didn't stop writing in Latin, but he popularized it with, first of all, La Vita Nuova. And I always sort of say, half tongue-in-cheek, that perhaps it's our first novel, quote unquote. And some of my colleagues look at me as if I'm being, you know, a heretic here, a literary historian heretic. But he wrote that before 1300, and of course this, the Divina Commedia, the Commedia as he called it. It was later, someone later added the name.
He generally referred to it just by that first word,
Commedia.
Correct? That's what
yeah.
I read.
Yeah. It's just genius. It's just absolutely genius in what it says and how he says what he says, the whole idea of the terza rima, that interlocking rhyme that just continues. We Italian Americans really need to take advantage of this year, the popularity, quote unquote, of a figure like Dante Alighieri. I mean, he's the resource. He's the sort of font of all, of most of, you know, the literary world when you think about it. I mean, the sonnet for which everyone thinks of Shakespeare, and rightfully so, because he wrote great sonnets, right? But the sonnet has its origins in the aforementioned Scuola Siciliana. And then, of course, Dante and many others, you adapt the sonnet, right? And then, of course, Francesco Petrarca becomes really the writer of the sonnet par excellence in the 1300s in Italy. And then we also have our prose writer, Giovanni Boccaccio. And then, of course, the Anglos come along, whether it's Chaucer or whether it's, you know, Shakespeare. So all to say that Italy really becomes this extremely important resource that then gives birth, whatever you want to, whatever expression you want to use, on a worldwide level to these two forms, you know, to the sonnet and to the short story. They're Italian in origin.
I think Dante therefore is the catalyst. He's the protagonist. He's the person,
right?
You know, who really is agitating all, mm-hmm. Starting the flame to mm-hmm. make this all work.
Yeah.
I'm just kind of wondering what we might do in 2022.
Hopefully we're all together.
Well, the committee will probably start thinking about that in January.
Yeah.
And we'll be scouring books and seeing, you know, what's the major theme for 2022.
There is also another poster
coming out.
And let me give you,
the booklet poster, by the way, of course, is Dante.
Right.
But in back, inside cover, is the poster with all 45 years. And of course, there are many notables on this poster. People such as Palladio,
mm-hmm.
and we have
mm-hmm.
Giuseppe Garibaldi,
uh-huh.
Antonio Meucci. It's like a litany. In terms of culture and heritage, you're absolutely right. For 45 years, we have done this magnificent story. I mean, people like Maria Montessori. Mm-hmm. Some people have said, we never really knew about her until you provided us with the poster. Or Mother Cabrini. That was a wonderful thematic time for us as well.
And we should say that she finally got her recognition in New York City.
Yes, and in Colorado.
The state
of Colorado has taken away Columbus Day as the name celebration, and instead they have honored Mother Cabrini statewide in Colorado.
Yeah.
So some of the work that we've done, I think we've stimulated people to thinking about it. And because our booklet goes out now digitally, so, you know, as you know, the Calandra Institute helps us get it to thousands of people. And then we'll print a limited supply in print, but try to get it to all the schools. That's mm-hmm. what we want children mm-hmm. to know the story about Dante.
Among some of the other people here, I think we have Christopher Columbus.
We do.
Now, even a full 30 minutes would not be enough to deal with Columbus. But, of course, he's come to the fore in the last 4 years. For 20-some-odd years, there was peace after the brouhaha in 1992. And then 4 years ago, of course, here in New York City, it started with then-president of the council, Melissa Mark Viverito, who said, we have to look at, after the Charlottesville tragedy, we have to look at hate statues, which is, of course, not a bad idea. but in that she lumped just basically everyone, including Christopher Columbus.
Yeah, it's a sad time. I think we learn from the past so much, good and bad. And we can't deny that there has been bad in many ways in this country and throughout the world. However, my personal feeling is that we can't correct everything overnight. And I think the way we correct it is through the classroom, by teaching both sides of a story. My mantra about Columbus has always been, Columbus was a discoverer. We cannot deny that. He did unite two worlds in the sense that recovering from the Ice Age, two continents that were once attached perhaps and were not. And he brought them together how? By meeting one another, bringing trade back and forth. Mm-hmm. The very fact that we never had a tomato, right, in Europe until he brought that back, or corn, or potato, whatever. So as a result, there was that part of him. But he was definitely a man of his times. And they were troubling times, because even his own men who sailed with him, and he left them there after the first trip, they took advantage of the Native Americans. We cannot deny that. Mm-hmm. We know that is a fact. But we also know that Columbus himself was not the murderer. Mm-hmm. He was not the thief. Mm-hmm. But he had a hard time. So for me, I feel that not so much we honor him, but we honor his spirit of discovery. Mm-hmm. You know, I've said it publicly and argued with those that don't agree with me. I would love just to have an Italian Heritage and Culture Day in the spirit of discovery and Columbus. Mm-hmm. And I would say that we have won some battles. Right now, whether we all agree or not, but in the city of Philadelphia, they are taking the scaffolding down from the statue that they had removed. Mm-hmm. Up in the city of Syracuse, they're still fighting it. Here, thank God, in New York City, our former governor was able to indicate it as a preservation site by the state. And we hope that that will last. But we have to learn about Columbus. We have to learn both sides of the story. Mm-hmm. And there might be some things that we don't want to face. And I know you and I have discussed this, not in any adversarial way, mm-hmm. but in a way of intelligently mm-hmm. discussing both mm-hmm. sides of it. And that's what I would hope comes out of anything about Columbus.
There are still more discussions we need to have, I think, on the Columbus issue. And I think, first and foremost, history is what we need to confront.
Yes.
And once we do that, then we can decide how, if we preserve Columbus, how we want to preserve Columbus, and so on and so forth. I've heard it from nobody that I've put it in print. And for me, the only way to save Columbus is symbolically. I don't think it makes sense to try to recreate the history of an individual about whom we know very little. The documents are what they are, and some people don't want to look at all the documents, as you mentioned, you know. And so we'll see. We'll see where it leads us. But I, you know, the idea of a Mother Cabrini, I can live with that. considering what someone like Mother Cabrini did.
Oh, she had an incredible life. Yeah. And the way she crossed the ocean so many times, she was scared stiff of the water. She did not like the water. In fact, the monument here in New York City at Battery Park is one that shows her looking towards Ellis Island with children surrounding her. It's a beautiful bronze statue. Yeah. She's on a boat, and that was one of the things that she really did not like.
She's sort of the Mother Teresa ante litteram, right? I mean, there was Mother Cabrini before Mother Teresa.
Yes. Yeah.
And while Mother Teresa did all the good things she did, I would suspect that if you looked at a list of things, maybe Cabrini might come out on top.
Yeah.
You know. I mean, it's something like between orphanages and hospitals, something like 50. I mean,
incredible.
If you do one in a lifetime, it's an achievement, right? A lifetime achievement, but she did.
My only connection to Mother Cabrini was a story from childhood that my mother's father, who was a barber here in New York on 2nd Avenue, that she would come to visit his barber shop with some of the nuns and the people. And he had his espresso pot in the back. When I was a kid, I would see this here. And he was a marvelous man, and that was the story that Mother Cabrini had touched his life. Ironically, when I was asked to serve on the Mother Cabrini Statue Commission, I was just humbled by it because of that connection. The big message that I would love to leave with the audience is that we need to be proud of our heritage no matter who we are, whether we're Italian-American, African-American, Asian-American, whatever, in a way that we espouse it through these notable people who lived in the past.
Yeah.
And that's what our committee does. It surfaces these people, and for that year says, wow, Dante 2021. Let's spend some time and learn more about him. And that's what we've been doing for 45 years. Mm-hmm. I've seen other celebrations in other cities and states, but they're not emphasizing that. They're talking more about events, about dinners and awards. But I think we need to talk more about heritage and culture and how we blend that together. So, you know, I think as we honor these other people in the past or in the future, we need to be a little bit more introspective about their lives, to share it with the world and say, this is what Mother Cabrini, what she was like, how she lived. Mm-hmm. So maybe we even need to study more about her.
Yeah. Let me ask you one more thing, and I'm gonna incur the ire of other organizations, but you've been involved in the Order Sons of Italy for like 55 years or something to that.
Since 1968.
Yeah, 53, yep. 54 years, yep. 53 yep. years. Just briefly, the Order Sons of Italy started as a mutual aid society.
Definitely.
People don't realize that, you know, that there was no wealth, there was no Medicare, there was no welfare. Now, while it wasn't the Order Sons of Italy, my grandfather in Stamford, Connecticut, belonged to a mutual aid society that was Vittorio Emanuele III. And I remember he paid a few dollars a year, and that got him medical. It got $100 when he passed away to the family to bury him. It doesn't sound like a lot, but in 1913, $100 was a lot of money. The Order Sons of Italy has grown. Most people know the story, but just relate it a little bit.
Well, we were founded in 1905 mm-hmm. by a Dr. Vincenzo Salaro, a Sicilian by birth, but educated at the University of Naples. He was a gynecologist and certainly a man, an early man of his times. He came to America, and with four or five compatriots, they would sit together down right at Grand Street, which is our founding site, 205 Grand Street, where annually we always place a wreath on our anniversary day. June 22nd is the founding mm-hmm. date of the order. And they decided they needed to take care of whom you described, the widows and the orphans. That was their prime concern. Mm-hmm. I would say that if any historian did a study, you would find throughout America where Italian communities were founded, that was their first goal and objective. All these mutual soccorso mm-hmm. societies mm-hmm. to bring to the surface the care of the widows and the children. Mm-hmm. And obviously they would establish these mortuary funds. Mm-hmm. And in fact, when I first joined the order in 1968 as a younger guy, I remember hearing, and they were phasing it out then because insurance programs were providing much more coverage.
Yeah.
So as a result, the Sons of Italy redirected his energies. So where would those energies go? Charity, but just a variation on it. So today, mm-hmm. the charitable work that we do all has to do with Cooley's anemia,
right. Exactly.
Alzheimer's, mm-hmm. autism, three major charities. Mm-hmm. And the way it works, since we're a grassroots organization, local lodges raise money, they provide it to the state grand lodges, and then annually, those grand lodges provide those monies to the Supreme Lodge, the National Lodge of the Sons of Italy mm-hmm. in Washington, D.C., of which I am now the president of the Sons of Italy Foundation, mm-hmm. which is the 501c3 group. So it's charity, caritas, as well as scholarship, mm-hmm. of which I'm very proud as an administrator at St. John's University right. to know that the Order Sons and Daughters of Italy in America is doing incredible work. And I was just almost at the end of our first annual, I hope, major national survey of what we're doing. Mm-hmm. We have exceeded through the states, local lodges, and the National Lodge over $650,000 in scholarship money. And no one really had ever spent time in 1 year. And that is incredible because the students today, as we all know, need it. I mean, college and university life at the private sector is anywhere from $55,000 to $75,000 a year, not to mention medical school, law school. Yeah. And another concern is to provide scholarships for the study of Italian. And I'm happy to say that we are doing that.
Yeah.
And our national order, we have had two students go abroad, the American University of Rome and John Cabot University for Italian studies.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I think that we were founded in 1905, but what we're doing in 2021 is incredible as well. Mm-hmm. I'm sure our grandparents would be really proud about mm-hmm. us. Because mm-hmm. as you mentioned, those were $5 contributions then, yeah. which was a lot of money. Yeah. Yeah. And now just to think about it, if a person gives $100 towards a scholarship campaign, and now to be able to say that we've raised all this money, mm-hmm. it's quite yeah. something.
Speaking of donations, the booklet that we have here, this is the printed version that we did here in-house at the Calandra Institute, is supported by numerous people.
Definitely.
And that's how the activities are supported as well, because the lecturers that we have, we give modest, but we do give an honorarium to recognize the work that these people do and their background and, you know, what it took to get them there. So to at least give them some sort of token of appreciation, we do. And so people can go to the website,
yes.
right? And people can, whether it's $5, whether it's $50, whether it's $500, all donations help. Right. And no one, and we should say also, no one who is part of the committee of the Italian Heritage and Culture Committee gets paid. It's no, all volunteers.
All volunteers.
Each member also contributes a modest annual dues.
I would say without the help and contributions of the Columbus Citizens yeah. Foundation that have agreed to the back cover
the back
of
cover.
Our beautiful booklet,
yes.
as well as to a second cousin of mine, Sciame Construction,
right.
and Con Edison of New York City.
Yeah.
And then we have other donors, such as the Calandra Institute, mm-hmm. not only in kind, but support us, mm-hmm. My own university. And then we have wonderful Cavalieri Vivian Cardia from mm-hmm. Florida. Annually, she supports a full page and the Order Sons and Daughters of Italy nationally and the state.
And the state.
As well as some local lodges. So,
right.
And all of our board members, I have yeah. to say, they do make an effort to contribute and yeah. their names are all listed in the book. Yeah. So that's a great mention for us. I really appreciate it to really get online. I'm hoping that this year, Tuesday, November 30th is Giving Day.
Yes.
And I'm hoping that maybe we can have our own little campaign.
Well, and you know, we as Italian Americans are very generous in many ways. You mentioned three for the Order of Sons of Italy, coolies, anemia, Alzheimer's, and autism. You know, but we also have a culture we need to support, right?
Yes, we do.
And it's getting better. It's getting a lot better. I can tell you the decades I've been involved. It's getting a lot better. The support for culture is growing increasingly. And I'm going to throw out a name here, at least for the Calandra Institute. We've funded by all the national organizations. We've gotten money for grants and stuff. But, you know, two organizations have helped us. Long term has been ILICA, the Italian Language Intercultural
yes.
Alliance, has been very supportive of the Calandra Institute. And, of course, more recently is Francesco and Mary Giambelli Foundation, who has also made immense contributions to our professional development projects, especially the seminar that we do on Italian Diaspora Studies Seminar in Rome for faculty. And
you're right,
students.
That's what we need. It can't just be about heritage and culture and writing and libraries. It has mm-hmm. to be the financial resources.
Right.
Without the money,
yeah.
you just can't make
yeah.
it happen.
So the book you want to see written about so-and-so, well, we need to pay that person to do
right.
it, right? And so on and so forth, yeah. Or the film you want to see about so-and-so. That people work, people have to dedicate their time and energies. We have to find the person who is qualified, who has qualified him or herself through education.
Maybe we can make an appeal to your audience.
Indeed
today.
We shall. Indeed we just have. So with that, I want to thank you for taking time out of your busy day
yeah.
because, as I said, you're wearing about four hats right
yep.
now, and you've taken the time. So thank you for joining us.
Thank you today. It's fabulous, and have a great month.
Thanks for watching this special episode of Italics. I'm Anthony Tamburri. Arrivederci alla prossima puntata.